shadow whiskey, and I won't smoke that cigarette, and I won't smell that sweet addiction on my breath, and I won't ride through West Virginia in a backseat Cadillac. As you know, some cowboys like me go out like that. But I need you like the needle needs a vein, like my Uncle Joe in Oklahoma needs the rain. I need you like a lighthouse on the coast, like the father and son need the Holy Ghost. Well, I want to get lost in some corner booth, a cantina of Mexico, and I want to dance to the static of an AM radio. Beside you, skin on skin, make love till the sun come up, till the sun goes down again. Cause I need you like the needle needs a vein, like my Uncle Boerne Oklahoma needs the rain. I need the Father and the Son need the Holy Ghost. Drink that shadow whiskey, and I won't smoke that cigarette. But you know, some cowboys like me go out like that.
And Miss Bridgette?
So I gotta go. I don't have no microphone. I can't. They don't want us to talk. We're women.
There's no microphone, Sam.
It got real quiet. I got real quiet.
Oh, he's
got. Oh, they're coming up.
He's working on it over there. I see him.
I'm a woman. I gotta be heard. You know what I'm saying? Did somebody say thank you? Seriously, could I get some more vocal though in the monitor if I could, please? I don't know, it just kind of disappeared on me a little bit. Mm-hmm. What's up, Texas? How are y'all? I love coming and playing in Texas. I ain't just saying that to say it. I really do. Somebody ends up really drunk, a baby's made, something happens every time. I love y'all. I'm from here, but they made me. If you don't want me to talk, just say it. I got a situation happening right now. That made me be from South Carolina. I reckon Jesus did that in my mama. So. And then they gave me a microphone. I don't like to hear. But my whole life I've been loud, so then the other part of me should have been Italian, and so it was only appropriate that this song came my way. My like my brother, Mr. Danny Mark. I don't know if you guys got a hold of him and got to listen to him, but he played with you one time before,
yeah,
didn't he?
He did show me with us.
Yeah, he's crazy. Mississippi Crazy. And so I got a hold of this song, and I got to record this song for the ACC, and I'm a Clemson Tigers fan, and I don't know if y'all are aware of what happened, but we beat Alabama. So I only approve it. I do this one first, because y'all will get used to me after a while. I do like it loud, and the song is called Loud. Listen up, shout it out, everybody in the house. Stomp your feet, clap your hands, come on, kick it with the band. I'm all about tradition. Is this on? Say, coming in all the cowboys, don't be scared to make some noise. You think you're sexy, you think you're strong, come on baby, bring it all home. Ooh, boys, I ain't your mama, I ain't the girl to stop. Don't say I didn't want you, baby.
Awesome, Bridget. Yeah, welcome to Texas.
Thank you, sir. I'll stay if one of y'all would keep me. Woo!
We can probably make that happen.
We can make that happen.
Brother David over there.
Thank you for having me here, David. I'm Bret Graham. I got some folks here from New Braunfels area that came out. Yeah. So, I've not been nominated for a Grammy or not a female Elvis, but I did write a song. You're not either. She was like, what?
He's really like, built me out of big. That's a lot of pressure, man. That's a lot of pressure.
But I did write a song that Gary P. Nunn recorded, and I've sung it at quite a bit of places, you know, and Bridget, you know, a baby might have even gotten made during this song. I don't know.
Good for you, man.
I was thinking about that anyway. One called Honkin' Out Some Hank. It goes like this here.
I wanna hear somebody honkin' out some Hank. I need a beer for my body. Woo! I came here to drink. You better turn up the jukebox. I don't wanna think. I wanna hear somebody honkin' out some Hank. Yeah, move it on over, love sick blues. still in love with you. A good looking, cold, cold heart. I wanna hear somebody honking out some hate. Hey, I gotta hear somebody honking out some hate. Got me a beer for my body. Woo! I came here to drink. You better turn up the jukebox. I don't wanna think. I wanna hear somebody honking out some hate. Let her go, Mark.
It's good to be home. That's all I can say.
Glad you're back.
Yeah.
Woo. Me too, brother. Me too. Me too. So I'm going to dedicate this song to my wife tonight. We're on Valentine week. Yeah. And that lovely girl went with me and $300. Sam, can I get a little more low end and volume on this guitar, please, sir? She went with $300 and an old beat-up pickup truck to Nashville, Tennessee, and risked it all on some little redneck kid that wanted to write songs for a living. And she struggled. She waited tables. And looking back, it doesn't seem like much of a struggle because we were so young, but it was. And it was a big risk, and she did it. And it paid off in a lot of ways. And then we got to come back home, and I asked her if she wanted to come back here to Texas, but to be back home, and she jumped at the chance to follow me down another road and another dream, and I just love her to death for it. So here you go, babe. Cody Johnson recorded this song. Well, I'm out here chasing these rainbows that I need to find.
Still there and still wants to be in the arms
bed and a phone.
Home, but we miss him in Nashville.
He's ours now.
Well, we might get him back. Don't get your hopes up.
I ain't never going down that road again, baby.
No. This microphone hates me, though. I'm going to tell you that. No, we ain't going to get you back, but he is my absolute favorite songwriter in the world, and he knows that. And I discovered him in Key West. Can I tell them how I discovered
you? Don't, yeah.
Yeah. No, yeah, come on. I was there in Key West, and we had a big songwriter festival that we had there, and everybody drinking, much like y'all do here. They're just in a special place there. So I was hanging out, and I had played a show, and he was supposed to play in this whole other line. Brian Davis played with you that night. And so I was going to stay and see Brian. Well, here comes this thing. And this thing has on a sombrero. And he's like 8 feet tall. And he's got his guitar. And he's doing like the drunk walk. You know what I'm talking about. And I'm thinking, who is this fool? This man ain't going to sing nothing. Do they think he's going to sing? And so I'm talking to my friends about it. And Danny actually stand there with me. And I'm like, this man cannot even function right now. How is he going to sing a song? And this sucker lifts up his head from his sombrero and starts singing stuff like, Lord knows I'm a lucky man. And I'm like, who is that? And he's like, that's David Lee. And I'm like, I'm in love with everything he's doing right now because he is drunker than anybody and he's singing better than anybody. So later on, I discovered him leaning up on the post somewhere like that Mexican thing, that shadow thing that you see your whole life. And I walked up to him and said, Mr. David, are you okay? And he raised up his head. Hey, are you hungry? And I said, I mean, I can be, something like that. I'm going to get Sloppy Joe. I didn't know they had Sloppy Joes here, but apparently he did. And we shared a Sloppy Joe, and I don't know where he went after that. Apparently it was a homeless man named Popeye, so he told me last night. But from there on out, I was like, that is my hero. If I could even half play as good as that and half drink that much, I'll be doing all right. So y'all are lucky to have him, seriously. Well, what are you doing? What's that? What? Oh, would you like to swap this out? okay, I don't know what I have here. I mean, if I hit it the right way, it likes me. If I don't, see?
Kind of like a cock.
It might be the cork.
Yeah, I think it's got short. Too long again. Oh, it's fancy and loud, too.
It works.
I like it loud.
I like it loud, but with no feedback. Okay, are we good? Hey, thank you for doing that. They wouldn't have done that in Nashville. I'm just letting them know they would not have, would they? They'd be like, no, you just gonna suck all night long and we're gonna blame it on you. So I gotta go to Vegas. I love going to Vegas, and I wanted to go cut a record there, and a manager found out that they had a studio that Britney Spears, they had built it for her and she never used. And so I said, well, we'll go use it. And we called them and booked some time to go play there, and I think they thought that the Clampets were coming in. And then, I really do, I think they just all stayed in there to see if we had teeth. Like Eminem. Eminem had been in there the week before. And so we come in, and we come in with what I do, and I had written this song. I'm from South Carolina, so tailgates and bonfires are our thing. I mean, that's what we do for fun. Much like y'all probably got, I mean, y'all got fire on your table right now. It don't matter where y'all go, you just got fire. And so I want to write a song about it, and so I come up with this title, and I took it in to a friend of mine, and we ended up writing this, and I got to cut it on my record. So hopefully y'all will understand what I'm talking about when you back up the trucks and somebody got coolers. Well, everybody's got coolers. And you end up getting funky in the country.
girl have a good time now. Do, 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 do. Can I get, I'm sorry, can I get a hello? Can I get a Coors Light, maybe? Please?
Oh, that's mine?
Yeah.
Oh, never mind.
Somebody knew what I liked. I got a Coors Light, but I like me a Coulter too, so.
Low on carbohydrates.
Well, it's not really beer. It's more like flavored water.
Dream on.
Oh boy. I'm in awe of these songwriters up here. I'm a big fan of people that go to Nashville and stick it out and hang in there and get her done. You know, I lasted about 2.5-3 years myself. I started out though, somebody about the time I turned age 20. Guy said, you need to write your own songs. I was doing covers, you know, and playing in bars and stuff. I said, well, wait, what should you write about? He says, well, you know, write about what's going on around you. So I lived out in the country. There was a fellow that used to ride his horse up and down the road. And I thought he was a real character. So I thought, well, maybe I can write a song about him. And I did. And I still sing it. This is one I dedicate to Roy. I still see him right now. This is Roy Lamoureux was the last real cowboy I ever knew. So, cowboy song for you. Was the last real cowboy I knew. He'd get up at sunup and work till a hard day was through. Riding and roping and herding them cows, not much to do, Roy didn't know how. They used to be many, it ain't that way now. And old Roy Lamoureux was the last real cowboy I knew. He'd round up the slickens and burn them with his rock and our brand. He bred them and he fed them and he drove them all over the land. They'd head for the bottom when the pasture turned brown. If they came to a fence, old Roy had cut it down. Some folks didn't like him, but they all lived in town. And Roy Lamoureux was the last real cowboy I knew. Yippee-ki-yi-yo, get along, little dogies. I'll play you a song about a hard-riding cowboy. Fellers like him are getting so few.
Real cowboy I knew.
I think they're probably standing out there by the fence looking over right now. They think Eddie Arnold's in here. Oh, that's great, man. That's great. That is something that I'm not sure that any generation past mine will ever be able to do what you just did. I think that's something that the cowboy way, that whole thing is I've seen it fade over my lifetime, and I know my grandfather, he was a cowboy, and he saw it going too, you know. And remember that old song, what was the one about the last real cowboy? The last cowboy waltz, Ed Bruce.
Yeah,
man. When I was a kid, it made me so sad because I thought, man, this is like the last cowboy. I mean, are they going away? I mean, and so to see somebody like you that's kept that alive is just, it's awesome.
Now they wear helmets.
Yeah.
Real cowboys wear helmets.
Yeah.
They do not.
Yeah, they do.
Dallas cowboys do.
Oh.
And the ones in the rodeo wear them.
If I come here again and y'all are wearing helmets, I'm going to be like, no. No. I brought in these tourist hats from Nashville. You're at least going to look like cowboys when I'm here.
Well, on the other note from cowboys, the other side of that is the hippies. And, my dad was kind of a hippie, and my grandpa hated hippies. Probably would have beat Ray Wiley Hubbard up. And so when I moved back to Texas, my daughter came in the house, and she was dressed up, kind of hippie-fied, and I asked her about it, and she said, well, Dad, it's just stuff that all the kids do now. They wear the, you know, it's just kind of the thing. It's kind of the new thing. And I was thinking, well, everything kind of comes back on it, you know. And so I was sitting there, and I come up with this idea, and I wrote the song in just a few minutes. And we've currently got it out now on Texas radio. It's number 47 on the Texas chart now. So, well, Granddaddy was a vet. He was a redneck man. He hated them hippie boys. He said they were the ruination of a whole generation, and their music was nothing but noise. He never saw this coming. I swear if he wasn't dead, he'd have a heart attack. 'Cause this whole town's letting their hair down and bringing hippie back. Turquoise rings and old blue jeans and peace signs on their car. The boys all look like Jesus and the girls all play guitar. Bring guitar. Hey, dude, fire it up. Come on, everybody, let's make love. I don't know how, but don't look now. They're bringing hippie back. You gotta hand it to Willie. Man, he's been around long enough. Hell, he's gone from cool to old school. Back to cool as he ever was. Hey, dude, fire it up. Come on, everybody, let's make love. I don't know how, but don't look now. They're bringing hippie back. I smell it on the wind, it's coming round again. They're bringing hippie back.
You should get Willie to sing on that with you.
You know, I tried, and the funny thing is?
He was high.
No. I tried to get him in the video. We shot a little video for it. I tried to get him in the video, and I tried to get him to sing on it. In fact, Bill Bradley kind of helped me out a little bit with that. And you know, they actually called me back, but Willie was in a... His manager, which the guy, one of his buddies, Willie's buddies at Pootie's told me, said, well, if the manager called you back, that means Willie wanted to do it. But... Because they just wouldn't call back. So I think he dug the thing, but he was doing something else. He was with Haggard. They were doing the Django and Jimmy tour.
Well, that was a good excuse.
So yeah, Willie's still working, man. He's working in San Antonio tonight.
Yeah.
He's playing tonight, which is awesome. 82 years old, he's still singing. Yeah, I mean, just don't get no better with it.
Y'all just gave us some good music. Thank you for that. Because it inspired all of us songwriters from different locations that ain't from Texas. So thank you for your music. I love it. I can't dance like y'all, but I can pretend to if you give me enough of this whatever's in this cup, sangria.
Hey, Bridget, I don't mean to interrupt you, but I used to have a funnel right here when I had to pee, and I could use it, but they took it away from me, so I've got to go.
Is that why that armadillo's holding that bottle?
No. That's Jose, for those of you that have never been here before. Jose he was a lug nut inspector at a little truck stop in Sweetwater, Texas. And he came across the border, and he had 18 brothers and sisters, and it was an 18-wheeler accident on I-20. And he was the only one left, and we snatched him at this truck stop, and we took him to Nashville. Now he's got his own Facebook page, and he's got his own songwriter show.
And he just turned out like that. Or turned up like that. All right, we'll let you go pee. We'll see you back.
Call it.
You know your harmonica part on this?
What key are you in?
I'm kidding. I'm totally kidding.
B flat. I got a B flat harp over here.
Oh, we're about to do this.
Bringing hippie back.
Do not mess with the professional. Tell you what, you find a good place to play in it, play on, brother.
That's right.
So, I know. I'm so glad to be here. Y'all have no idea. I'm not just saying that. I really don't go around the world and just say that, because there's places I hate to play, but I have to go. This is not one of them. Every time I get asked to play in Texas, I'm like, please sign me up. I'll play for free, whatever. I just love it. Thank y'all for loving music, because y'all listen. Thank you. Y'all actually care about what we are doing, and that means everything to us, don't matter where we're from. So, me and David Stacy were talking earlier and talking about childhoods and all that mess that you get into. And I wrote this song with Heather Little. And if you don't know Heather Little, she's from Texas and she plays a lot at the Forge in Ben Wheeler. And she had me play there before and I love it. And we were talking one day and I wanted to write with her real, real bad. And I thought, man, she wrote that Gunpowder and Lead song and she left out so much that we could have used to kill men with. And I thought we could try this again. No, I love y'all really hard, but I just, y'all, it's a great song. So I thought, well, I could go figure out maybe with her whatever she didn't use and write some kind of high octane stuff like that, because I don't write a lot of ballads, as you can tell. And I sat down with her and we got in that room and we started talking about our dads and talked more about our dads and our childhoods and kind of what trailer parks looked like and I mean, what motels look like, living in cars look like, and all that stuff. And so, unfortunately and fortunately, that was our childhood because it made us be who we are. So the more that we sat there, she goes, you know, B, I mean, I don't know what they talking about when they talking about being a daddy's girl. And I'm like, not unless it's something dirty. I don't know what they talking about neither. I don't know what they talking about. And so we kept on talking through it. And then later, after I had recorded this song and we were pitching it around Nashville, Tiffany, the artist Tiffany, I don't know if y'all remember her from the 80s. She had come into Nashville. I think we're alone now. And she had heard me sing this song over and over and over. So at one of the writers' nights in Nashville that I do at the Bell Court there, she kind of did this inappropriate, like Rascal Flatts thing. And I said, did you just Rascal Flatts my song? She goes, I want to record that song. And I was like, never mind, Rascal Flatts on, Rascal Flatts on. And so she did. She cut it, and it's on her current record that's out. And she's been touring, and the song is called Daddy's Girl, and I will always be proud of it. But man, when Tiff sang it, it kind of hit home. And I don't think I've ever had one of my own songs make me cry before, but I stood in the middle of the floor and cried, and that it made sense to me, and it made sense to Heather. So I hope y'all like it.
Daddy's girl.
Follow that big boy.
Didn't need no harmonica.
No, he worked that part out while you were gone. See what he did there?
That just about made me cry. Getting all verklempt.
Truth. Gotta write the truth.
Well, this one may be a good one to follow it with. It's what'll happen if you cross a gal. She got a way of getting even, you know what I'm saying? This one's called She's Dancing the Blue Right Out of Them Jeans Tonight. A young green-eyed cowgirl fell for the fiddler in the band. A tall, handsome wrangler who had the fastest fingers in the land. He swore that he loved her, his kind could never be true. He made her blue, now he's fretting on the bandstand. She's stepping out with someone new. She's dancing the blue out of her jeans tonight. Is turning every cowboy's head inside. While his fiddle's faded love, her red ropers feel feather light. Yeah, not too tight, but she's dancing the blue out of her jeans tonight. He parked his old horse in her barn, swept her away with his brand of sweet country charm. As they loved in the moonlight, she held the man of her dreams. So it seemed, till he rode off in the sunset. He left her as blue as her jeans. Hey, but now she's dancing the blue out of her jeans tonight. The way that they fit her, turning every cowboy's head inside. She's dancing the blue out of her jeans tonight. Yeah, she's dancing the blue out of her jeans tonight.
You gotta love that. Man, you just gotta love it. Don't have a damn choice.
I do.
Dang, I could just get you to play that again and just over and over. And I could just sit here and I just smile ear to ear like a dang Cheshire cat over here.
Do we have to sing anymore? Just let him do that thing. And keep going,
yeah. That used to drive me crazy, though. I listened to Bo Bob Wills records when I was a kid. And I wanted to punch Bob. Yeah. He would be like, oh, I'll take it, Leon. And Leon would start, and he'd go, oh, Leon. And I was like, shut up, Bill. I can't hear what he's doing. Bob. I mean, you could never, he would walk all over these guys. They had some of the greatest players in the world, but he would walk all over them because he was still in the spotlight the whole time. It would just drive me nuts.
How you really feel about that?
I mean, I love Bob Wills. Bob Wills is a legend and forever will be, but it's just that drove me bananas. Like Tommy Duncan, let Tommy sing. He's singing. Quit saying, oh, singing, Tommy. Oh. Come on, Tommy. One more time, Tommy. It's like, shut up, Bob. Go sit in the corner. So a few years ago, I moved to Nashville and got this little gig with John Michael Montgomery's management company, company called Hallmark Direction Company. They signed me to my first publishing deal, and John was at the height of his thing, and there was this fat little drunk guy that laid on the couch all the time with mustard stains on his shirt. And evidently, he was the guy that shined the flashlight up the back of the stage when John Michael would come on and off stage. And he would get sometimes too drunk to turn the flashlight on.
So what you're saying is you used to shine the flashlight except you ain't short and fat.
No, it wasn't me. It was this other little short fat guy. And so he's laying on the couch, and I'm going, okay, who is this guy? And Estelle said, that guy is going to be a star. And I said, oh, yeah? He said, yeah, that's John Michael Montgomery's brother. His name's Eddie. And Eddie does drink a lot, but I'm telling you right now, he sings better than John does. And I said, oh, okay, I get that. He was playing drums and doing Elvis impersonations. I mean, Eddie was a trip. But I got to know Eddie, and we became friends. And he took some of my songs in and went, and him and Eddie and Troy got a record deal and became Montgomery Gentry. And they used my songs to get the record deal, and then they didn't put any on the record, and then they became big stars and disappeared, and I didn't see them again for a long, long time. And things were really good for them. And I walked into the Longhorn restaurant there. We used to spend a lot of time at the Longhorn in Nashville. That's where all the songwriters, all the great old songwriters, like Harlan Howard and those guys, at 10, 11 o'clock in the morning, they're in there drinking White Russians and hanging out, you know. And so we're in there, and Eddie was sitting at the bar, and he was drunk, and it was about 11:30. And he said, hey, man. I said, hey, Eddie, how you doing, man? He goes, they told me that you wrote a song I just recorded. I said, really? He goes, yeah. He said, damn, I love that damn song. I didn't know you wrote that song. I said, that's why you recorded it, Eddie. Anyway, it was the number one song for me. I have days when I hate my job. This little town and the whole world too. Last Sunday when the Cowboys lost, Lord, it put me in a bad mood. I have moments when I curse the rain, and then complain when the sun's too hot. I look around at what everyone had, and I forget about all I got. But I know I'm a lucky man. God's given me a pretty fair. Got a house and a piece of land, a few dollars in a coffee can. My old truck's still running good. My ticker's ticking like I say it should. I got supper in the oven, a good woman's loving. One more day to be my little girl's dad. Lord knows I'm a lucky man. Friends that would be here fast, I could call them any time of day. I got a brother that's got my back. I got a mama who I swear's a saint. I got a brand new rotten reel. I got 2 weeks off this year. Dad had a close call last spring, and it's a miracle he's still here. And a piece of land, a few dollars. taken like I say it should. I got supper in the oven, a good woman's loving, and one more day to be my little girl's dad. Got supper in the oven, a good woman's loving, and even my bad days ain't that bad. Lord knows I'm a lucky man. Yeah, I'm a lucky man.
My brother loves that song, the bad one I told you about, but either way, he loved it, so
oh, yeah?
You can bet it was bought, yeah. Buy the bad one. You got the bad one's money. I'm happy about that. Well, whatever. We all got family problems. They're crazy. I have been waiting for this song to get cut for a long time. It's the most ignorant piece of work I've ever done. And one of the most proud pieces, but Alyssa Moreno, well, I was kind of cracking on Rascal Flatts a while ago, but she wrote this great song with Jeffrey Steele for Rascal Flatts called Every Day, if y'all remember that song. And it went number one, did all this great stuff, and she is a Pisces like me, so we always joke how opposite we are, because she's all, that is a Pisces, y'all. Did you just clap for us? Man knows what's up. We'll clap for ourselves. Sensitive, but we need to be recognized at some point. I mean, you know what? It's the best sign in the zodiac, whatever. I'm kidding. We love all of you. So we're sitting in the room one day, and I had maybe 2 hours to write. And y'all know that's a short time when you've only got a couple hours to be in the room with your buddies and be able to write. And I hated to cut it short that day, but I was going to write with another artist, and I need to get done with that. And so I told him ahead of time. And we got in there, and Liz likes to bring in incense and throw around leaves and stuff like that. Y'all think I'm kidding. This is real. She'll open up windows, and she'll say, we need to let energy in, and today feels yellow. And I'm like, today feels like we need to write this song and stop figuring out what color it is. But she come in this day at 2 hours, opening up windows, waving around whatever she's waving around, whatever. Who knows what she called up, conjured up in there, but... We're sitting there, I'm right with her and Drew Davison. We're in the middle of this rocket thing, and I was in that mood, and I'm like, yeah, man, let's get this done. We'll have this done in 20 minutes. Well, in the middle of it, Liz goes, we need to stop. And I'm like, no, we don't need to stop. I got like an hour and a half left. We need to keep chucking on through, keep chucking. She said, I need to tell you a story. Well, Liz is from Arizona, and her friends are all from California. And nothing against them California people, but they are always on a cleanse. And this is all she wanted to tell us about. This was the whole story. I'm serious. In the middle of this ride, she goes, I had a friend. She came in from California. She was on a cleanse. And I said, what is the point of this story? Well, we took her downtown to Tootsie's, but she couldn't drink. Well, then why would you take her to Tootsie's in Nashville, Tennessee, if the girl cannot drink and she's on a cleanse? Well, because she started drinking. And I'm like, that's what you do when you go to Tootsie's. And so the girl ends up drunk, and she said, and guess what? And I'm like, what? I'm sitting on the edge of my seat waiting to write the song. She goes, her yeehaw side came out. And I said, stop everything. We are writing a song called I Can See Her Yeehaw. And we did! We did! Yep. This is for you with the crown on your cowboy hat there. I think, I have a feeling that you're this woman that I'm about to sing about. I'm making a dedication to you right now.
Her yeehaw's out.
Her yeehaw's hanging out, people! So, all I could see was that girl when Reese Witherspoon did that thing from Sweet Home Alabama where she went into the bar and she showed up stuck up, you know, and she all of a sudden got her accent back, and then she was from Alabama. That's all I can see. Like, we have to write this song. And so I wanted Trace Atkins to cut this real, real bad. Could y'all hear him going, I go, sir, yee-haw. I'm like, women be naked. It don't even matter. He just sell it just for that. But he didn't. He didn't. And so I met Uncle Si recently. And Uncle Si is going to sing this song, y'all. And y'all just wrap your head around that. Yes, the dude from Duck Dynasty is going to sing this song. So there's a part for y'all, and I'm in Texas, and I ain't even got to tell y'all what to do, so I'm just gonna play the song for you now.
Showing off her, hey-haw, watch my
song I ever wrote, but I like it. It worked.
There is something about her yee-haw hanging out that makes everybody pay attention.
She said it, I was like, that's stupid and amazing at the same time.
Lead in the Hummer.
Now that's twice as funny because I drive a Hummer.
I'll never live that down.
All right then, time for a sad song here. I don't write too many of them, but this one here's got a little redeeming factor, hopefully, and there's a little truth to it. One called The Man of the House.
Doing, Stacy?
We're gonna draw three names.
We're drawing three.
That bucket.
Okay, we got gift bags here that we're gonna give out, and I'm gonna draw. No, I'm not gonna draw them because I don't want to be biased. I want to make sure there's no cause for anybody thinking I'm
Let
Trump
Jose
or nothing.
Draw.
I'm going to be like Trump. I don't want nobody thinking I've done nothing wrong, so I'm going to give somebody else a chance to do this. Okay. Stirred up.
Like Bob Marley.
I ain't looking. Let this young lady right here come and draw a name. Just draw, just reach in the bucket and draw a name. It doesn't matter. You can't see in that bucket. So whatever you draw.
It's
who
Rick.
Is it?
Yodi?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, hello.
Come get you one of these Jose gift bags. Yes, ma'am, we got t-shirts and stickers and all that good kind of stuff in there. Okay. Sir, would you come draw one for me? Appreciate it. I love that bolo, by the way. That's cool, man. I'm a turquoise fan myself. Who we got?
Milmar.
I'm going to mention, I've actually recently just finished my first recordings here in Texas. We now have it for sale. The first record that I've done since I come back, I did with Tommy Dedimore here in San Antonio. And that record is available tonight for the first time here at the show. And so y'all be sure and pick up a copy of that. Sambo, can I get a little more vocal in this monitor, please?
Yeah. Earl or Vicky?
Probably a little of both.
Earl. Five people stand up.
Yeah, it just says Smith.
Where is Sam?
Smith.
It's Rick.
All right. Y'all put your hands together for this man. He's been to every single Jose show we've done. It only serves right that he gets it.
The mayor of
Boerne. The mayor of Boerne right there, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to do a song that's on this new project that I just did. And I wrote it with this sweet lady right here. We wrote it before I left Nashville. And we sat one day and just had no idea and started pounding some stuff out. And along came this song. I was thinking about my buddy. Hello. It's a little hot. 2, 1, 2. I'm going to back this up a little bit. Okay. There's a guy named Jose Villarreal that worked for my dad when I was a kid. And most of you that have been to the show know about Jose. I've told you about him and the work ethic that he gave me that I applied to everything that I did in my life from pouring concrete with that man, and I always talk about him when I play this song. John Wayne. I said, yeah, but this place ain't what it was. That eagle don't fly nearly high enough. There's taxes and the price of gasoline. And I've got a wife and kids who count on me. You shouldn't have, but it made him laugh. He pulled out a photograph and said, someday I hope they're here with me. Cause you got John Wayne, Disney World, a chance for every boy and girl to rise up from the dirt. If they're not afraid to work, and you got Elvis, you got Chevrolet, apple pie and baseball games, there's a spirit here you can't find any place. You, Bridget, but I got.
You got the pee?
I shouldn't. I'm taking medicine because I've had the flu for 3 weeks and I'm just now getting over it, so I'm finally back to singing again. But NyQuil will hurt you.
Why'd you step out there, David? Mine ain't quite soaked in yet. I didn't go far, I gotta admit.
Well, I would just like for y'all to know that I shall hold my pee until the end of the show. I will stay seated and keep my hands inside. Oh, I thought they were both leaving me. I was like, this is about to get crazy. I was going to be like, how crazy? Y'all want to get up here now? So, alongside men like David Lee in Nashville, Tennessee, that we get lucky enough to even be near or sit in a room with. You know, there's other guys like Jeff Steele. I don't know if y'all ever heard of him, but if you turned your radio on, you've heard of him a whole bunch. Ooh, I got some. This microphone don't like me neither. But alongside people like that, there's a guy named Jeff Steele, and he writes pretty much almost everything you ever heard. And it's hard to get a writing point, let alone just know him in general. So I found out one night as I was sitting at the Governor's Club, which is nowhere I would actually be, but I was invited to a dinner there. It was a golf course, whatever. I don't know, some kind of fancy stuff I wouldn't be at. They invited me to come to this birthday thing, and I had this wince and pain going on in my side, and I thought it was gas. It was not. It was a tumor. So I was hanging out with this record exec that night, and I'm telling y'all this because this leads up to this song. And I said, Jim, I think I got to go. I think I'm in a lot of pain right now. I think I got to go. And he, you know, called me every name in the book. You just don't want to drink with me. Well, I kind of don't, but I still, either way, I got to go. So I left, and yeah, like 30 seconds later, I ended up in the emergency room and got there as quick as I could. And I had tumor the size of a softball that had been hanging out with me. And by the way, if you pay for them things, they don't let you go home with them. I was really upset about that. But I didn't know I didn't get to keep it. I mean, I'm just being honest with y'all. You pay a lot of money to have that thing taken out to not get to keep it. So I had this big whopping surgery, and so there I lay. And then I thought I was going to be, I really like Wonder Woman. So I thought, I got this. 2 weeks after I had my surgery, I scheduled this really big writing appointment with Jeff Steele, which is about as good as scheduling it with David. and you don't get one very often, and you don't cancel whatever happens. You, it doesn't matter if you're dying. If you're hanging out with your guts, you go to that writing appointment. So I kind of literally was hanging out with my guts, and I went to the writing appointment, and my friend that was helping me kept saying, Bridget, I don't think this is a good idea. I'm like, you understand, I have to go to this writing appointment. So I couldn't even pick up my guitar, my computer, nothing. But I thought I could lift up the world as long as I had lower tabs in me. See, lower tabs make you do amazing things. And so when I walked in the room with Jeff, I looked at him, and he had his cigar. And I said, Jeff, and to be honest with you, I had a surgery, and I'm on the lower tab right now. And he pulled a cigar out and goes, cool. And then I said, so Jeff, right?
Yeah.
Cool. I said, but we're going to write a song. Regardless, we're going to write something. He goes, cool. And he turns around and we start talking. And I don't remember everything that I said, but I got stuck on this word, reminiscent, like Rain Woman for a while. I can't say Rain Man, but Rain Woman. And he started playing his guitar lick. And the next thing you know, we had created something that reminded me of my papa, and I think probably his dad, and Mr. Randy Houser ended up cutting the song. Put it on his newest record that was out called Fired Up, but the song is called Back, and I hate it if it don't ever make it to the radio, but I'm glad to play it for you now.
Yeah.
rehearsing those Main Street nights with the radio loud, just like I did when I was a kid.
Man, that's a lot of words to remember.
It is. And then when you do it like one, two, three, like four keys lower, and you have to find your balls, it's hard.
Yeah, when you ain't got none, it's real hard.
I looked down and went, well, I'm already in the middle of it now.
So, yeah, I'm a fan of them dance halls, and, you know, we was talking about that Bob Wills music. Decided to write a little tune to celebrate that. Called us, Let's Get Back to Those Honky Tonks Again.
Yeah.
Like this here. A-do-do-do-do-do. A-do-do-do. Let's get back to those honky tonks again. A two-step to those tunes from way back when. Like the keys in the mailbox, come on in. And let's get back to those honky-tonks again. Flashing neon lights and swinging doors. Cowboy boots shuffling across the floor. So pretty, it's a sin not to get back to those honky tonks again. So what do you say? Let's get back to those honky tonks again. And do step to those tunes from way back when. If it's heartaches by the number,
brother. I just love it. That just makes you miss what used to be right there. I love it. Great. I'd be remiss if I didn't get Brian Black up here to do a song if you would. Yeah! Come on, man. Come put your hands together for Brian here. He's not Clint Black's brother either. Clint Black is his brother. I'll make that clear.
Right here, brother.
Oh my gosh, front and center?
Front and center.
Unless you can be left-handed.
No, I can't do that.
Well, you know, y'all caught me at a bad spot here because, what do we got here? Let's see. Is that, oh, is that yours?
It was a free pickup.
So, no, I'll tell you what, y'all, I'm a better singer than I am a songwriter, and I rely on these guys to make me sound really, really good, because I'm a terrible guitar player and a not too bad songwriter, but...
But a hell of a singer.
Well, I'm not going to say that.
I'm confused right now. What is he good at? Everything? Is that what he's saying?
But, so I don't even know if I could sing one of mine, because I don't know that I could play it, but, what are we saying? Somebody else's, would that work? Somebody, like, something like Merle wrote or something?
Ain't nobody mad at Merle. Uh-huh. Ain't nobody mad at Merle.
Well, thank you a bunch for inviting me up. I appreciate it, David. Thank you. And I'm glad you folks are coming out to keep this kind of stuff, alive. You know, it's rare that people will actually sit long enough and listen to what writers do, and it's wonderful. Thanks a bunch, y'all, for coming out tonight, and I appreciate you making me part of it, David. Thank you. You guys are great. Well, let's see. How about this? How about we do one? Merle wrote this one, from what I understand. The first time he met Dolly Parton, he fell in love with her and went home that night and had a few drinks and wrote this song and called her up in the middle of the night. She happened to be sleeping next to her husband, and he wouldn't let her get off the phone until he sang this song, Always Wanting You.
It's in G. You know it? Yeah. Well, you probably play it a whole lot better than I.
Get your intro for it?
Sure, you betcha. Nervous as hell playing in front of all these great guys. So what I'll do, I'm gonna let you play it. Bob, what do you think? And then that way on it. Oh no, let's just go right on.
Right there. Okay.
Yeah.
There we go.
If I turned away, never looked at you a second time, 'cause I really had my life all together till your eyes met mine. Fell for me. Wish I had a way of knowing all the things we had in mind could never be. Always wanting you.
sometimes hurts me almost more than I can stand.
I'll tell you what I really do. You know, I grew up liking Merle Haggard was the first guy I ever started singing, you know, and then, of course, Frank Sinatra, too. So yes. We're going to go ahead and jump into one of Frank Sinatra's tunes right now. No, I'm only kidding you. These guys would have to play it, of course. They probably can play it, you know, but that would be hilarious, wouldn't it? You know, fly me to the moon. You know what I mean? I've got you under my skin. Yeah, he could probably play all that swing stuff, you know. David, do you like that swing stuff too?
I love
it. What key do you do? Fly me to the moon in. I play it.
Whatever Frank did it in, was it like a B flat or something?
Yeah, I do it in B flat.
Yes.
Kiss me. kitchen and a door, and other words bleeds me true, and other words I love you. Woo!
So cool. I met Brian. I know he didn't remember because he was a big singer. I was just a little guy playing the little rooms around Dallas, and he was at Cowboys one night, and I went back there, and I think Gary Stewart was there, and Brian was performing that night, and I was just a kid backstage, just like, hey man, how's it going? Shaking his hand. And it's really weird when I was sitting here and he was singing and I was thinking how time flies and things change and life goes on and people, and how you circles and come back together again and things like that. And it's really cool, man. Thanks for being there. Good friend here. His name happens to be David Lee. He's sitting right there in that checkered shirt with that black hat on. And he was one of the first guys I met when I moved here back to Texas. And met him in a Shade Tree Saloon, a little biker bar over here off 281. I was in there having some beers with my wife, and he was sitting at the bar. And he had all his biker stuff on, so he kind of freaked me out because I didn't know, I really hadn't spent a lot of time around bikers and biker bars and stuff like that. You know, I've been around a lot of rough honky-tonks and stuff. I played a bunch of them, but I really didn't know biker people. And Dave was sitting over there, and he had all of his stuff on, his black stuff and his chains and all of his stuff. And he kept looking at me, and I was thinking, what the hell is this guy looking at? He's like, he's kind of scary dude, you know? And finally, I just made eye contact with him, and he went, hey, I'm David Lee. I went, oh, you're jacking with me. Thinking, he said, no. I said, I'm David Lee, too. And he said, yeah, really? And I said, yeah. And so we started chatting, and he said his daughter, who had been killed in a car accident as a teenager, her name was Stacy. And he was telling me that, and my wife, Stacy, was sitting there. And it was really strange. All of a sudden, I'm like, okay, this is weird. Meeting a guy named David Lee with a daughter named Stacy, my wife Stacy. So we're meant to meet here tonight. And we talk, you know, and chat a little bit. We've become friends over the last few months over the last year. And Stacy went out of town, and I got to spend a weekend with Dave hanging out. He invited me over to his place, and he's got a cool little spot he built where his biker buddies can come hang out, and they got rooms and stuff. You know, he's got beds and stuff back there. And his life was dramatically changed when he lost his daughter and his wife. And we sat and chatted, and I looked at his, I just kind of listened to his story and his life, and I was just, I was amazed, and I was so thankful that I have the life that I have, and that my life hadn't been changed like his has, and how proud I was of him for being able to withstand the stuff that he went through in his life and come out to be the good guy that he is. And I got a glimpse into his world, and I wrote this song about it. It's called Lorena. Lorena is hard, but she's pretty. Broken with fire in her eyes. And I'm just a cowboy that rides an old Harley. But I sure love making her smile. We both have our scars from the others, so we try not to hang on too tight. But every now and then we take off in the wind. Lorena's here with me tonight. Just a warm body, and Lorena's here with me tonight. Now we've got a whole lot in common. She likes some good Mexican food. I ain't saying it's perfect, but it's easy. Sometimes she'll lay by my side. She might take off and run when the cold morning comes. But Lorena's here with me tonight. Took a ride out to Boquillas. We took in the canyons and the stars. And she revealed a softer side of herself, and I thought maybe. Well, life is one hell of a road. God bless those who walk it alone. Somebody, not just a warm body. And Lorena's here with me tonight.
Situation. I'm proud of you.
Yeah?
Yeah, I'm proud of you. Glad I didn't have to go next after you sang. So, this thing is, all these microphones here hate me. I just want y'all to know that. This keeps cutting out. Hear that? What? Huh? Yeah. In Nashville, I don't know if you, Yeah, it's cutting out. I don't know if the batteries are done. But anyway, when we write there, they don't let you say certain things, or they tell you ain't supposed to say certain things. So if you start talking about cowboys or cowgirls, or you start talking about horses or spitting or Towns. Whatever. Small town, anything that you have, you can't talk about guns, you can't talk about nothing. So, except for that girl. Remember we talked about that? It's on the radio over and over, whoever that girl is, they keep writing about her. So, Christy Lee Cook is an artist that sat on Broken Bow for a while, and Mr. Jason Aldean was cutting some songs on her, and she come in and we kept writing. And I'm like, Christy, we write all these ballads, and I mean, it just ain't you. You know, you're a barrel racer, and you like wear camouflage every day of your life. Like, if you had to go to a prom or something, you'd wear camouflage. I mean, that's what you do. And you shoot everything except for men, but you'd hunt them too if it was legal. And so I just didn't understand why we kept writing these songs over and over. And you know how it is. You get in the room and you just keep talking and you're like, we're not writing anything that says anything about you. And so she said, well, they don't really want me to say any, you know, they don't want me to say anything about camouflage or ammo. And so me being me, she came in one day and I'm like, you know what? I have an idea. We're going to say everything in one song. What's the worst thing they could do? Say we don't like it as opposed to everything else we keep writing. And so we did. We wrote this song called Looking for a Cowgirl. And behold, that was the song that ended up being the single for her. And I was proud that we wrote it because it was her, you know. She needed to be her own artist. So something you probably never heard in your life, but you're going to hear it right here. Baseball cap. We can do a little riding, we can do a little fishing, do a little hunting, show you what you've been missing. Keep it going on till the sun comes up. I'll roll you on home in my pickup truck, in my pickup truck, yeah.
So Bridgette was telling me last night that she's befriended Cy on the Duck Dynasty deal.
Yeah, he's my buddy.
That's some funny crap she was telling. They're fixing to do, like, y'all doing a show, right?
Yeah, we've been working on a show. We've been in rehearsals. If we could ever quit laughing at each other, I think we'll do a show together. Yeah, we're in the stages of planning for it. We're going to do a record and everything, so y'all look for that. Tweet your neighbors. Y'all's neighbors are far, so you have to tweet them.
Brother, we got time for a couple more here.
All right. Gosh, you know, the last time I was in Nashville, David, was, 1996, I believe. I stayed away from that town quite a while. Then, you know, it's, the town can beat you up. I don't know if you guys know that, you know, in a lot of ways. It can.
Look at me.
Walking, talking, living proof, right? There you go. But no, last time there I was in the Greyhound bus station in Nashville, Tennessee. And boy, I was just downhearted. And the night before, I'd prayed to the Lord. I'd said, God, I feel like I've screwed up my life, and I need you to show me a sign to help bring me out of this funk that I'm in, you know? And so the next day at the Greyhound bus station, I bumped into this little homeless-looking guy. For some reason, I struck up a conversation with him. And throughout the conversation, he says, I think I asked him, I said, what do you do? He says, I'm a minister. I said, oh, ordained? He said, by the power of God. He said, matter of fact, he said, God has given me the ability to see things about people. And matter of fact, he showed me something about you. You've been through something that's nearly wrecked your spirit. It was a woman. She cost you a lot. And I thought, man, you hit the nail right on the head. I said, I believe you're a man of God. I really do. I said, can you help me? I remember this, like we were sitting in the bus station waiting on a bus. He said, God filled Bret with the Holy Spirit from the bottom of his feet to the top of his head. I felt a 2-year weight lifted off of me that I'd been carrying around. I told that man, I said, his name was John Larimore from Junction, Texas. I says, I want to sit beside you on the bus. I want to pick your brain. I want to know what your secret to life is, you know. And he said, well, Bret, he said, get hungry for the Word of God. He said, you can look in there and you can find things that'll open up your life for you. And I'd grown up, you know, going to Baptist church, so I knew about the Lord. I'd been saved and baptized. And matter of fact, John Larimore showed up 20 years later. This was about a year ago at... It was a New Year's Eve at Twin Sisters. My old buddy John Larimore showed up in the parking lot. I was fixing to do New Year's Eve over at Twin Sisters Dance Hall. And just let him know. I said, thank you, John, for what you did for me then. And just keep on carrying on. He's a hillbilly get-about preacher. And he inspired this here song right out of the book of Luke 15. I went to my father. He said, I want some cash. He scraped up all he had, and he gave me half. I packed my suitcase and headed out west. I spent a lot on wild living, and I blew the rest. Broke down at the Grey Dog, I was all alone. Bus back home. My heart was heavy and all my hope was gone. When my prayer was answered through a man named John, I didn't find Jesus when I strayed from the fold. In the darkness, too blind to see, I didn't find Jesus, he found me. Thank you. met me at the final stop. He saw me coming from a long way off. I said, I'm not worthy to be called your son. He took me in his arms and said, welcome home, son. He put a ring on my finger, his best robe on my back, new shoes on my feet, and killed the fatted cat. Then he threw a party, oh, you could hear the sound of a celebration where the lost are found. And I didn't find Jesus when I strayed from the fold.
Fun. I enjoyed playing with you at Green Hall, and I'm so thankful you come out and joined us tonight. I'm gonna do one more, and then I'm gonna let Bridgette close it out.
What? I don't want to go out.
You still got one to play that I love, that changed your life, and
it,
you got
it the... did. Well, Jesus changed my life. He was talking about the man changed my life. I reckon it's a song, but. All right, okay, I'll go last.
Okay.
Pressure.
So I wrote this with a good buddy of mine, David Frazier. Spent 30 years in Nashville trying to write songs and worked in the oil fields in Texas and then moved to Nashville with three kids and a wife. And you can't even imagine what that was like. I mean, I did it single with my wife and I just by ourselves, but I couldn't imagine moving with three kids and spent 30 years doing it. And didn't pay off one time for him until he was 60 years old. And he just had a number one song. And I was so tickled to death for him. But I asked him one day, we were at the lake house, and we might have had a few drinks. It was about 3 o'clock in the morning, we'd been fishing. And he said, I said, Dave, what makes a man hang 30 years with something that ain't giving him nothing back? And he said, David, sometimes I feel like even my pain is hurting, buddy, but I just got to keep going because I believe in it. I love it. And I said, can we write that? And he said, what? And I said, even my pain is hurting. I love that title. Can we write that? So we wrote it and didn't realize the next day that we'd actually written a song. Believe it or not, we were pretty inebriated. But somehow or other, even when you're trying to screw up, the muse comes to visit and you can't help it. It's just there. We edited a little bit the next day because Hemingway said to write drunk and edit sober, so that's what we did that night.
Even my pain is hurting.
sing worth what I owe. I've been all my life hoeing that rope. Like a sucker, I bought what they sold. But that yellow in the ground ain't gold. I've been a cage bird singing, waiting on freedom, feeling like my prayers ain't working. Won't you loosen my chain? Laying on the table next to a bottle of Old Black Label. Can't be the only thing, he's a man's burden. I said, Lord, can't you give an old boy a break? You said you wouldn't give me more than I could take. This old world can sure rattle your face sometimes. CDs for sale out there out front. We're going to have merch and other kinds of stuff. Y'all pick up. I've got my new CD with me, so y'all be sure and pick that up. And I know, Brett, you've got
CDs. I don't have any CDs.
My stuff's on iTunes.
Okay, well, get on iTunes. Do you have a website, too?
BrettGraham.com. Okay. Brett with one T.
Brett with one T. Okay. I spelled that wrong the other day.
That's okay.
And also, DavidLeeMusic.com.
BridgetTatum.com. I have lip gloss. So if any of y'all decide that you want lip gloss that has a light and a mirror on it, it's beautiful. I just want to plug that too. I mean, I have CDs too, but lip gloss.
Oh, you're selling lip gloss?
No, I really have it. No, like for real.
Oh, so yeah, so buy you some lip gloss.
Yeah, or get your man to get you some.
Dave, y'all need some lip gloss. I know you need lip gloss. Every cowboy needs some good lip gloss.
You know what? That'd be like the best pickup line ever. Could you put this on me? Wouldn't that be awesome? I mean, if you were single, you're not single, but I'm saying if you're at the bar and you're a guy and you got lip gloss in your pocket and you just hand it to somebody and go, could you please put this on me? On you first, on me. That's a great thing. That's worth the $20 right there. Y'all, thank y'all for letting me be here. Thank y'all for letting me play with you on this stage.
Well, I can't thank you enough for coming all the way from Nashville and taking time out.
I'll come any time. You know that. I know that. And I saw him last night, and I saw Stacy. I was like, man, this is like coming home, even though I'm in Texas. It's like coming home, though. I love y'all. And you are awesome. And the fact that you just played that song a little bit ago, I mean, praise Jesus. I'm with you. I get it. I get it. Half the reason I even get to sit here is because he gave me this song, and it's hard enough to get anybody to listen to anything. And I'm sorry that Nashville was not as sweet as it should have been. I really am. But you know what? You're exactly where you're supposed to be, doing exactly what you're supposed to be doing. And it is hard. And then you go hang out with David, and he's got like 15,000 number ones. And then you're like, lo, see my barren field except for this one number one song. But it was important, and it was important for country music, and I just wanted to rhyme Kakalaki, because I'm from South Carolina, and we say South Kakalaki, North Kakalaki, and then Jason Aldean made me change that one line, and I was mad at him at first, and then the money came in the mailbox, and I was not mad at him anymore. But I wrote this with, I call him my brother, Mr. Danny Myrick, and the song was She's Country, and it goes like this.